this is a meeting of the Leominster School Committee, and it is, believe it or not, September 6th, and we are here at the Appleseeds Restaurant. Would you all stand and join me in a salute to the flag?
We can go outside.
Somewhere. Anyway, so outside, right there. Can't miss it. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, welcome, everyone. We have a light agenda tonight, which means we could probably be here at 11. That's usually how light agendas work. But having said that, we will now read our work. Leominster School Committee statement. The Leominster School Committee represents the needs of all Leominster Public School students and places their interest above all others. We will exercise leadership, adhere to our protocols, and base our decision upon a reasoned assessment of all available information. We will advocate for each of our schools and support high-quality public education in Leominster. We welcome our guests tonight. Thank you for coming. We'll be doing a report, you said? He has to report back.
He's going to tell his class. He's in Mr. Hanson's lead class. Nice.
So we will open up with a public comment period. Does anyone like to address the school committee or so? Just come forward to the microphone and just your name and just for the record, please. Once again, one last time. We'll now close this portion of the meeting. Now move on to, we're going to go right to approval of the warrants. No. Are we?
Not tonight, no.
We're not going to do it tonight.
Another one.
Is this right?
Communications.
Looks a little bit different. We'll go to communications.
Through the chair, there are no communications for the committee this evening.
Okay.
Just go down to 7 o'clock.
Oh, that was the 6 o'clock meeting. Okay. Public comment, communication, superintendent's report.
Okay, just quickly, we had a very successful start of school on Wednesday, August 31st. I had the opportunity, as I always do, to visit every school during the morning, to welcome students back and to visit classrooms. So it was exciting to, actually the students didn't even indicate like it was anything new. They had a few weeks off and were coming right back to school, so it was a nice welcome back. The only school I didn't get to was Leominster Center for Excellence, but we followed up with them the following day on Thursday, and Carrie and I spent time with the senior class, which will be the graduating class from LCE, and talked a lot about their internships and other work that they were doing. So that was a good experience meeting them on the second day. We welcomed kindergarten students back this morning. Unfortunately, there was some misty rain out there, so the normal assembly outside of Pre-Street School probably couldn't happen. So I didn't go by there in the morning, but they started their K-12 academic careers in Leominster today. So that was exciting. And then just as a follow-up for the committee, we had the technology report last meeting. And all of the projectors that we procured are now in place in the building. So our biggest objective was to get Skyview done. I didn't think it would be done this quickly, but the technology director reported to me this afternoon that all those projectors are in at Skyview and the staff is thrilled. So I'll go up there now while they're thrilled. check in to see how things are going. So as we move forward in the academic calendar, we have a four-day week again this week because of the Labor Day holiday, and then we'll be back to our regular schedule of five-day weeks, which will be good for academic time up until the weekend of October 7th through 10th. October 7th is a professional development day. October 10th is Columbus Day. So we have a good block of time to get our students in classrooms, get them moving forward until our next break in October. So that concludes the superintendent's report.
Okay. We're going to now move on to presentations and committee discussion. We have an interview with a potential school business administrator. Len Fratto?
Fratto.
What, Fratto?
fraternity.
And then they shorten it up?
No. No.
Are you sure? This was your chance.
Hydrella?
You could have made it a good story. In any event, we welcome you to join us here. We have a glass of water there for you and a microphone and a very comfortable seat.
Thank you.
We all have our name plaques there, right? Everybody has theirs. Kind of show.
Yeah, don't show.
Am I in the right place there? Yeah. Right person?
Hi, Glenn. Thank you for coming. We appreciate you joining us this evening. There's some prepared questions that the committee members have, so I'll turn it back over to the chair and he can facilitate the process.
All right.
We'll move along as quickly as possible.
You look ready. You want to go
ahead? We picked a question. Brendan, let you walk in.
Okay.
You want to take number four?
No, just, go ahead. We'll just jump around. Yeah. She looked ready, so I figured.
No, I was just getting ready.
Oh. Is anybody ready? No,
no, no, sir. Hi, thank you for coming. I'd like to hear your overview of your background. And from looking at your resume, I noticed some gaps in there. And if you could explain those gaps, okay?
This isn't like a
2-minute. Here's a chance to put in your good story.
I'm the son of a Cambridge school. You know anyone with my last name? They're all public servants, most of them school teachers. I took a slightly different path, primarily because I don't think I have the patience or temperament to be a school teacher. I've learned that as a parent, foster parent for many, many teenagers in my early years. Very good high school athlete, gave me the opportunity to go to a very good college, which in turn gave me an opportunity. Very good graduates. I've been blessed in many regards. A lot of the cards I've been dealt with, wonderful, great family, great children, grandchildren, blessed with grandchildren, and fairly good health. I am a professional public servant. I am a money guy. I worked the first half of my career as a municipal administrator, as a town manager. I decided I wanted something different when I was a town manager in Westford. I wanted to be more like the Lowson County Superintendent, who's the school business administrator. And I've done that for better half of my career. I said earlier, I've dealt a number of wonderful cards. I've also dealt some difficult challenges. And they relate to my health. They relate to physical challenges I've had to address. I gladly explained it in detail, but real simple, I've had 2 cranial surgeries, and as a consequence, had seizures, which would allow me to drive. So the bottom line is, when I can work, I've worked. I love going to work. I love contributing to an organization and making a difference. And I think that would be a great assistance to the superintendent and to the school, given what I've been both as a school business administrator and as a municipal administrator. Most recently, I've served as a consultant, still the public sector organization. Projects I was working on early this spring are both in the way. So I'm available to work with whoever your needs are, your needs are.
Do you have a commute? Is it going to be
It's a 35-mile commute. That's about 2 previous times of the month it's taken less than 55 minutes. It's a reverse commute. And it'll be one of the shortest commutes I've ever had.
And what interested you in this position?
I want to get back to working full-time as a school business administrator. And the job I enjoyed most in that regard was in the film, which in many regards is similar to others. If you go on the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education's website, you do that district analysis research tool, they'll show you the 9 districts that are comparable, both in socioeconomic status, enrollment trends in terms of the district. Methuen is not one of them. Pittsfield, West Springfield, I wrote some down. Peabody, Quincy, Salem, Somerville, Taunton, and Cambridge. Cambridge? Cambridge spends twice what we spend on education. At
We spend it better though.
It's because of their economic base. Methuen is more similar to Leominster than any of the other countries. And I love working in Methuen. I understand it. I took a job that they considered more money. Didn't bargain with it. It's nice coming to work knowing you work with a group of people committed to the same goal, mm-hmm. serving the students of the city. And I think we have some challenges. And I think we have some opportunities. And I'd love to assist the chairman of the school, the mayor, in trying to address those challenges.
Okay, thank you, and thank you for being honest about the gaps.
I can be more specific.
No, don't need to.
I told you, this is your chance. If you get 3 Academy Awards, this is your chance. A lot of the questions here are based on, you know, are you familiar with DESE requirement? I mean, that's pretty much, Munis, did you guys use Munis?
No.
You didn't use Munis?
No, I used Munis as a town manager. We used Infinite Vision.
Yeah.
Which is budget senseless, most departments have a budget senseless.
Who's ready?
I am.
Go ahead.
Hi, how are you? So, how do you see the role of the business manager? You know, how do you see you helping us? How do you work well with principals? You know, how do you take all those pieces and make us successful?
Use an analogy. The mayor is Bill Belichick. He's the head coach.
I wished.
This is the rest of the coaching staff. That guy right there is Tom Brady. Tom Brady needs someone to prevent forces that are coming at him, provide the information he needs. And I'm the center, I'm the line protecting implementing your game. I've been in the trenches for decades. I understand DESE, I understand school budgets. I understand the school administration because I was one. In Methuen, I came to the district in a time of severe need that my immediate predecessor actually spent time in. And the public was on the case of the superintendent. Not understanding why she couldn't do everything they wanted her to, fiscal constraints of high school funding. And I came on board, and her goal to me was to make sure that everyone used the business office, which had retained it, as one that was now transparent and accountable. That's what I did. As a town manager, that's what you did. You want to make sure people feel comfortable spending money wisely. You are not the same situation as far as the team in the business office, because the business office is very well run. And you've got Tom Brady here, who's been playing this game for decades. But you do have the fiscal challenges that every district faces, particularly those that budget for the next school spending requirement. And I have some tools like that that we've used, using the phone and the assistance.
Can you give us an example of that? So, and I do have a principal in the audience, and an administrator. How do you work with the principals? You know, what's your?
When coming to Methuen again, there are only 5 schools. There are 4 very large elementary schools and high school. And one of the goals I had, meeting with G. Witness, was to make sure the department heads and principals had direct line. So I participated in every administrator staff meeting, called the leadership teams. Anytime the principal met the superintendent, I was there. A lot of the stuff I understood, I still understand rubrics, some of that stuff. But they knew that I had an open door and I had an open phone. And when I presented the budgets, the very first time I did the budgets, I actually came to each school and we had public meetings. Superintendent, not only teachers, but all staff and parents to come in so they could understand the school budget. To that point, they really never understood the very basics of educational funding. And And they learned that where the money was being spent, how it was being spent, and the fiscal constraints that the city was being pressed on. They got there right after the gravy train had slowed down. I don't know if Leominster, it seems like you had some, many good years of state aid coming in double digits. Methuen had that too, because Rome was growing, state aid was way ahead of spending, and budgets were going up 6, 8, 9% a year. I got there in 2009, just when the economy tanked, state aid flatlined. It's been going up marginally since then. So there aren't any real panaceas for increasing revenue in a community like this. There aren't any options. The best thing to do is try and find ways to save funds in particular lines. Whether it's transportation, whether it's trying to maintain especially the students within the district with appropriate services. I spent a long time talking to Ned, who's right on top of that as well. Are there ways where you can try and manipulate the state aid formula to increase revenue? Yeah. The more students that you, or families that complete free reduced lunch applications, the larger your bump in the state aid calculations. It's roughly every student that you can convince is eligible for free or reduced bumps the state minimum fiscal spending up by about $3,200. So in Methuen, we had a lot of students, a lot of ethnic groups that did not want to partake of free and reduced lunch. They just didn't want to do it. But we wanted them to do the applications. And you had to convince certain groups that those applications were not to be available to any other source. They're concerned that filling an application might risk something in the immigration service. But they would solely be used to determine the eligibility for the federal free and reduced lunch program. And we had, at the time, each of the principals had roughly $1,500 of funds. Wow, $1,500. We have 1,200 students. But I convinced them to use that money, can't use it for the lunch program, to use that money to buy prizes to bring students to a lunch. We had this huge citywide thing that even if you're not eligible, if you bring in a completed application, your name will be put in the lottery for bicycles and iPods. And the number of students, and the students telling their parents, you know, I don't want the food, I just want to have a chance to get the bike. And the number of hundreds of thousands of dollars of increase in expenses. Things like that. Understanding the formula. Things in the
year. I have the next question, and some of this you've touched upon, but maybe you can expound a little bit more. What is your experience with sort of the DESE financial regulations, municipal accounting, and general accounting work? So I know you sort of touched a little bit, but if you could get a little more.
Extensive?
Yeah.
Exactly. One of the rules of the school business administrator is to serve as a compliance officer for the district in regards to making sure you meet the requirements of school spending, that you properly coding all of the expenses, and properly encumbering the expenses at year's end. I knew this when I was a town administrator. One of the reasons I got interested in school education was the very first budget I proposed as Westford Town Manager was the largest increase in history of the Western school department. I don't recall the exact number, but it was up like 12% increase over the prior year. And the headline in the Western Eagle was, town manager slashes school budget by 9%. Because they'd asked for 21%.
Right.
So I don't know what the newspapers are like here. Wait a second.
They would have said 10%.
The Donkers are fooling the superintendent. Said, John, what are you doing? And he said, I've been working this headline. That's the largest increase the district's ever gotten. But I know that their power is stronger than just simple facts. How you analyze that information? have extensive experience in Hissell County as a town manager. All the districts I've worked in, I did Schedule 19 interview reports. In municipalities, I'm the one who wrote the management plan and all.
I mean, one of the things that's crucial, I think, for us is having a really good working relationship, you know, from the city side with the school side. And, you know, hoping that everybody's stuff balances and, you know, we're all on the same page.
I understand that there are, that the accounting communication is something that needs to be worked on. And given my experience as a municipal administrator, I think I may be in a unique position to help with that, that cooperation. I can tell you, as a school business administrator, I had a terrific relationship with the city department, whether it's in regard to bulk purchasing energy, soliciting solar power, and working on an ESCO agreement, a new services contract with NORESCO for energy improvements in the public sector. Working with the city's maintenance staff to consolidate facilities maintenance. And where we brought the city's historical staff in the same union as the school department staff. And did that with cooperation of all. In fact, that went so well that we then contracted out custodial janitorial services to elect the Greater Lawrence Education Library. Now it's Crescent Library. We maintain that we have properties because we have such an incredible team. And it's on-site, in-school electrician, HVAC technician, we're spreading it out by all the other organizations.
Thank you.
Next. Is ready?
You started to touch on this, but based on the fiscal constraints that public educators have to mention the state funding issues, what is your approach and philosophy to develop your state budget for us to go with that?
Initially, the school business administrator worked with the department and the school superintendent. I have a base budget for what we just spent in the prior year. That's the base. I think 95% of the expenses are moving forward. I said earlier, look at the areas we may be able to save expenses or control expenses. But the actual, in my opinion, the actual leadership on what budget initiatives the superintendent should be looking at are from the divisions. What do you call them? In the Thune, the school community would tell us, what would be the cost of doing this? What would be the cost of doing that? How much would it cost to do this? How much would it cost to do that? And we provide a list of those options. Unfortunately, most of the time when you prepare the base budget, going into the following year, we may take into consideration the cost of increased health insurance, retirement, and wage increases. The number is more than 100% of what the allocation is. Typically, this may not be the case, but the mayor provides the target. Official of the city provides a target for the budget numbers. And you build your budget based on that. So if it's 68.1 million, for your opening base is 68.4 million, as we are. But if you want 150,000 to do this, 120,000 to do that, you can save 50,000 by doing Z. And those are the options you give the decision makers. There's budgets aren't like rocket science or capitalist. It's building a foundation. Unfortunately, in Massachusetts, particularly the last 6-7 years, the foundation is just that. It's just the foundation. It doesn't provide you anything above that in regards to that source of energy. And I don't know what the state will have in your position to approve what it shares.
I'm sorry, I came in late. My name is, I don't know if everyone introduced themselves, but I'm Heather. That's a very nice to meet you. Citing specific initiatives or activities, how do you report and discuss financial information to principals, department heads, school committee, and superintendent?
Monthly financial reports. again, I don't know what detail Superintendent Zucker provides to you. It'll be at his lead, what information that he required or direct. But at the beginning of every year, come the end of October, early November, most principals know where they stand, where they will stand by the end of the year based on the finances. And they may be looking, whoa, put that person on the bus a lot more than $100,000 for that. Oh, wow, we had one student who wasn't budgeted, who left the district, who wanted to get this education. I know that's not usually the case, it's getting around. But monthly financial reports and open lines of communication. If you have the proper accounting system, you know where anyone who knows how to use that system, prepare a simple report, understand where they are. There should be no surprises come up in the year, in the year that we have to go. That's the role of the school business, no surprises, especially in school. The last thing you want is to hear about or learn a newspaper that something's wrong. That happens. I'll give you an example of one thing, and that was with the way the internet works, kids with telephones. Very different from when I was growing up. I want to say that because that if you have a field trip and a bus starts breaking down over the side at 93, before the transportation company can call the dispatcher, who can call the transportation coordinator, we notify the superintendent, parents were already calling the superintendent.
I thought you were going to say call AAA. That would have been the smart thing to do.
Perhaps the parents are still going to call you. And my child's on the side of the road, what are you going to do? And we already talked to the transportation company, they're sending another bus to be close to the side. This particular instance was in Methuen. So we sent out the contact police chief, we shared the building, and we sent someone to make sure that the children were shared. But no surprises, no surprise. That's not only the school business administration, it's also in my experience in the town.
So just as a quick follow-up to that, what action would you take when a shortfall is identified during the process of regular financial reporting?
Talk to the superintendent. Make the superintendent into the obligation. I work with the superintendent. You have an appointment, but there's appropriate lines of communication. I would never talk directly to the superintendent. Any materials I prepare for school from the packet, I need to embed into the superintendent.
Cool. Hi, Glenn. Thanks for coming in and answering our questions today. On the topic of communication, actually, you know, as you know, it's not always easy working with elected officials. So I'm going to ask, can you describe some of the challenges you've had to overcome working with elected officials and municipal administrators, and maybe explain how you've established positive working relationships?
Well, have you had difficulty working with elected officials? Boy, can I tell you stories. I'll get back to Methuen. Got there, the school committee was distrustful of the school business office. And in regard to that, I was not very confident. What Superintendent Wood and I decided to do is we put together an ad hoc finance with the objective of understanding the community's concerns about school finances and hopefully educating. I didn't know at the time that she was giving all of the biggest critics of her on this committee. We had representatives from the youth organizations, the principals are all out designated somewhere. And there was a school committee, two of them were this year. But it's amazing how much people believe in this information. I guess if you're watching the current cycle for the presidential election, that should be interesting. I remember sitting in this room and asking people, what are your concerns? What are your suggestions? What information do you need? And I clear as a bell. Two men in the group who happened to be husbands of school teachers. And they made a comment, or word for it, that if you get rid of these eight positions, that you can save $500. And it surprised me because these eight positions were members of the teachers. They were the best teachers in the district that had promoted to staff. They put curriculum and the coaches, the instructional coaches. We have a 10% premium marked on the salary to be coaches of the other teachers, especially when they have large district settings. And I look at them, if we eliminate those eight instructional coach positions, we do realize that those eight teachers go back into the classroom. Given the salaries, the last 16 teachers hired, we give them pink slips. No one explained that. But there are consequences of every budgetary decision that understands those consequences. And ultimately, that committee put together a report explaining, I'm a primary writer, but it was edited by all of them, explained to the community that they budgeted at net school spending. That was, the school committee was in full agreement. That was a target the mayor provided at the beginning of the year, that we will budget at net school spending requirement so we can maintain and collect 100% of our chapter spending. Well, that worked until FY09. But then when the grade return was stopped, that was really difficult. Fortunately, the current presidential regime, we got ARA, and that's the funding to help us through a couple of years worth. We actually went out and sought grants. I don't know if you were part of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the men's grants.
Yep.
Oh my gosh, what difference that thing. It was actually in a chapter of how much the turnaround the number of students who needed achievement tests, AP tests. 15 students, and 3 years later, 375 students. Just by challenging them, having teachers willing to spend the extra time and the grant proceeds to challenge these students. You show them the body you want from the process, and most of the students will be just need the right approach and direction.
Thank you. Mr. Ron?
Good evening, Glenn. I'm glad you could come here. I'm happy to be able to interview. As Gene said, my name is Ronnie. And I got two questions. The first one, what safeguards have you and would you employ to ensure the budget is balanced annually? And secondly, what is your approach to formulating make a recommendation to the superintendent in case the fiscal budget has to be reduced for various sundry reasons?
During the budget process, you understand the balance of funding certain items and not funding others. Hopefully you do as good a job as you can during the year, but there are issues that you can never prepare for. Whether it's an ice storm that destroys some roofs, we have to put up some funds, get those repaired before we collect the insurance, or whether you have a student with special needs moving to the district from another community, and still you have to stop paying their tuition. That's very some lines of communication. Open lines of communication with everyone, whether it's the facilities director, the spend director, services director, here. No surprises. Safeguards, anytime you're not going to write a check, you're not going to process a payment unless there's an invoice that's been approved to process and make sure there's funds. As you review the expenses, encumbering expenses for some major things, you know what they are. You may have encumbered 90% of salaries at the beginning of the year, 95% of salaries, and you track them over the course of the year to make sure that they're not going to go. If you need the high-end staff, you have to have a revenue source you can transfer. Basic accounting 101. As I mentioned earlier, there are surprises during the course of the year, they don't sell. Move them up the chain, make sure that a good, accounting software system that's properly maintained, proper inputs, you should never be surprised, as long as you're tracking the expenses. As soon as anything goes over 100%, or is tracking it over 100%, you gotta address it. You can't wait until May, June, July. It doesn't do anybody. But as far as lines of communication, you make the department head aware and find out what the reason is for things going on. You can bring it right to the superintendent office. Maybe the finance can get for those schools. They are how you track together. Not that complicated.
Thanks.
Part of our need, in my opinion, is the whole forecast committee touched on the whole matter and sort of keeping track of the balances and sort of unforeseen issues that might come up. But if it really needs some help, it's just the whole forecasting. So if we make a decision, there's somebody there to remind us again that there's a cost to that, and that we remember that down the road as we're making other decisions, so that we don't lose track. And because our meetings get pretty full with, you know, the agendas are pretty full, over a couple of months you can forget, you know, that you had made a decision. And if there's nobody there to remind you in terms of what that implication might be, you'd get yourself in trouble.
In the film, there was an extensive financial report provided every month, and it showed all the expenses by category, summarized it just as they do the DESI child accounts, where accounts are. And there are footnotes that explain where issues are. And if I'm doing my job, and you get those reports, and you read those reports, there should be no surprises. And I'm not sure the amount of time you spend, but there was a point in the film where we would go 12 months without a question on the financial reports. Because all the information was there. Anticipate what the questions are.
How do you feel about a very involved finance committee?
If you provide the information, you can anticipate the questions, you provide the answers in advance. You don't necessarily have to do it in a public session. The information is there. I've been working very engaged, very involved in the information for this business administrator and the school administrator. I don't think there's anything you can do or any question you can ask that will surprise me. I can tell stories, but not just.
You'll have more stories if you
trust me. Let me just go back. I understand the monthly reporting. I guess what I'm saying is, if we make a decision tonight to fund the program or something that's $150,000, and we can afford it right now, all right, that isn't going to show up in the balance sheet every single month, because that revenue source may come from, I don't know, could be a grant, and that grant's good for a year. And again, in terms of forecasting, we're keeping us in sync with, hey, remember, you've got this $150,000 grant that's going to run out. You've got to be keeping in mind that, you know, there's an increase in the bus transportation cost of 3% the second year. You've got to, so in other words, that's probably our biggest and greatest need right now, and I think all of this. I mean, you're good at what you do. I can already tell. I mean, you know the business. But that's probably, I would say, in my opinion, the greatest need is just keeping us on task with what we've thought we had enough money for, or, you know, that clock is ticking and that grant, it's impossible for us to keep track of every grant one runs out, what one overlaps, what other funding sources picks up. It's not, I mean, everybody has got another job, they can't do this full time. This isn't Cambridge, we can't do this full time. I was going to get that in soon.
Hey, I'm not from here.
I know.
Just
had to get that in there. So everybody else has something else to do, so we don't have staff that's going to be able to, you know, staff that's say specifically for the school committee. So keeping us on task in terms of remembering that, you know, we agreed to something and that $150,000 has to be there at the end of the year. That's really critical. And that's every organization that I'm part of. Everyone has that sort of crawl, you know, that creeping away, and we forget those things. And that's why a good business manager will remind you on occasion, wait a minute, don't forget you have this, and you have that, and you have this.
I assume the business manager participates in all the school committee meetings. Digital. Right. And get back to no surprises at that module. if you're doing your job, there are no surprises.
Okay. Thank you very much.
That's it?
Do you think you need 2.5 hours?
Do you have any questions for us?
I would say questions. Jim, Penny, Ned were terrific. I spent hours with them. They did not paint the roses. They were upfront. They explained the challenges the city was facing. I saw this once in a letter, and I'm going to let it as a reference. And one of the people said, Len is always willing to take on a challenge, comma, perhaps two of them. And that's just my nature. I love solving problems. I like helping women and organization move forward. I like serving children. And there are some things that are on my resume that aren't directly related to the job, those gaps. In the private sector. I was a foster parent for years. There were 90 teenage foster parents. That, fortunately, my wife took care of that part. I was just the cook, the caretaker, and the taxi driver. Helping move people forward. My very first two foster daughters were sent to the one was an African person. So we make a difference in people's lives. That's what I'm about. Thank you.
We can go right into this. Instead of keeping him here, we can go right into this conversation now rather than making him wait here. We planned on discussing this. Vote for appointment of an interim school business. So we move down to action item number 5. We can open that up for discussion. That's great. No discussion?
Jim, I can ask, you spoke to Sue. I know you spoke to her a couple of times.
Yeah, I had a couple of conversations in between time with her, talked to her about what the options were. And she unfortunately wasn't able to be with us this evening, but she didn't really state anything specifically in regard to the individual other than what was stated at the finance subcommittee.
I mean, I haven't been part of the finance subcommittee, so I'm only basing my information here, but it certainly sounds like he brings forth some good experience, having experience on both ends of the process. Hopefully that will help repair some of our relationships and communication so everybody's working together. We talked about transparency, and I think that's something we've been harping at for a while. A lot of things that he talked about, some of the things we do already, some things would be good to take a look at.
So interim would be a year appointment, correct?
That's correct. Through June 30th of 2017.
Does anybody have a problem? I mean, does that seem to be?
I'm good with that. I just want him to hit the ground running. Yeah. He looks like
he knows what he's doing. He knows the business.
Now the other thing that I'm not sure if you noticed in his resume, but he also has charter school experience. So as we're dealing with the charter schools, he was an administrator in charter schools, two different charter schools. So he has that background also, which is helpful because we don't have a lot of depth in that area because we're mostly public, straight public right. School district type of administrators. So.
So somebody want to make a motion to
I'll make a motion that we appoint him to an interim position of 1 year ending June 30th, 2017.
Second?
I'll second.
All right. And is salary sort of something that you discussed?
Yeah, we'll negotiate, and what I can do is I can work through that. I have a number of other contracts, and we can take that up on September 19th, brief the committee on all of those issues, and then we can make final determinations. So.
Just one question. Has he said how soon he if we did hire him, how soon he could start?
He could start immediately.
But he's not working for us now, so he has to go from Meyer, I mean, to take charge for physical, all that. I mean, you've got to do all that. Pending all that, then he can start.
And Jim ultimately is looking for full-time permanent?
Yeah, and he has been upfront with me that he's willing to take an intro role, so.
And he commits to us for the year?
Yes.
Okay, so motion is second. Questions?
One small question. I realize it's for interim, but when's the drop dead date that we tell him that we want more than just the interim?
Well, I think we need to get through the year. We have another option out on the table, which the mayor and I want to continue to discuss, and that is whether there's something under the community compact that we can maybe do more to streamline finances in the city. We haven't gotten that far yet. But depending upon how that evolves during the course of the year, then we'll make that determination. So
I think a couple months, if he's working out, he's interested in us, and we're interested in him.
You know, I just didn't know where to put a rider on that.
We'll write the contract for a one-year interim, and then usually I put wording in that based upon ultimate decision by the superintendent as to whether we'll continue the contract or not. So.
Well, if we can give him a look, I mean, in fairness, if he gives us a little bit of time, like, listen, I'm probably not good. I'm going to finish it out, but I'm not going to be interested. Then that, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And vice versa, if we feel like, you know what, okay, did a good job, but why don't you finish out the year? I think at least if we gave him 30 days notice or something, I mean,
so
2 weeks just isn't enough
day.
Anymore for anybody. Yeah. 2 weeks just, that takes you that long to fill out the paperwork.
Right.
But I'm just saying, at least 30
days. It's a good question.
For both people, you know, for us and him, that if it doesn't.
I think we've also done that for many of our administrators.
Yep.
It's a 30-day.
Right. Yeah. It just takes so long to put out the street, update the resume, get it on the street, advertise it.
Right.
And then a month's already gone. You're sitting in an empty position. So it's a motion and a second. Any other questions or comments? If not, all in favor? Those opposed? Okay.
Right, thank
you. So I thought he was still here, but I guess he's left.
I'll move forward. Yep.
We will now go back to
he's in the car.
Update 2B, which is update on the Center for Technical Excellence. I like that. Just made up a name.
I don't think I went technical in our title. I'm not sure we're ready for technical.
The whole world is technical. Can't go in a parking lot anymore.
I'm going to wait for him to come back so he can hear our presentation, so he'll be really excited.
Well, why don't you get started?
Can you update us on the on the contract and where you are?
Yep, I want to show you first where you can find us because I know that you are all really interested. Has everyone seen the new Leominster Public Schools?
Yeah, it was presented last week.
So we go to schools, we go to high schools, we go to LCE, we go to visit our site, and this webpage is not available, of course. So I have a little box on this webpage. Speaking of technical, Dean, maybe we need to get a little more technical.
No.
There's a box on our page that says, follow us to our new home. And on there, I have updated, I put the floor plan, I put photos, I go in every now and then and take photos and things like that. So let me give you a little update about where we are. So the contract was, in fact, executed the 22nd of August. It looks like I spoke with Nicole last Friday, Nicole Whitney. It looks like at this point they're going to need a full 4 months to do the build out. But you know me, I'm not afraid to ask and collaborate and see if we can move that along a little bit. They've been fantastic with us. What they have done is they have painted all of the ceilings and the beams. The elevator has been ordered, and they're planning to start the framing this week. And Nicole is going to meet with me and a couple students in the next couple weeks to pick finishes and talk about the interior design piece of that. So some real world learning for our students. Questions?
Well, it's the devil's question.
Right.
Is there new wiring going into this?
Yes, there'll be new wiring. There's no HVAC upstairs at all. Like, this is why it's going to take a while, right? Like, it's really rough.
Make sure with the wiring
wiring, if they're going to be using a thing that has a lot of wattage, you can still use it on two outlets. Because otherwise, what happens, it will trigger something to shut down.
Al has to meet new code because it's more than 60%.
I know that. But I'm telling you, even though meeting with the new code, I'm asking you, make sure it follows that. No matter how much of a big thing it's using, wattage, it's not going to trip it.
And the only thing we have to do through the chair is we need to connect up with the IT director in Verizon. Now that we're underway, to be able to get the networking piece connected, because we'll have to ultimately not physically move the line, but reconnect to City Place from what we have in place at Doyle, so that Gary and her staff can connect to our network. So that piece still has to be designed. So now that we're underway, we held off until we knew that they were starting to work. But there's a head-end room on the first floor of the building. We'll figure out where we need to connect, and then in turn, they'll do the internal wiring for communications, data communications, and access points, so wireless access points like we have in all of our other buildings. So
Kerry, basically it's just a shell.
Yeah.
And everything has to be built out.
Yep.
That's why it'll take 4 months.
Correct.
Two questions. How cooperative is Doyle being with staying there on a month-to-month? These are two questions. Also, the transportation, once you're moved in, will their busing go there? And can you take more kids once you're in there than you can right now at Doyle? Or do you have your capacity now and you're a little overcrowded?
That's three questions.
That's why I said that. I did correct myself.
So busing, yes. The bus company knows that we're going to be eventually moving, and they'll just reroute our kids. We have three buses in the morning and three buses in the afternoon. I think it'll be a pretty easy it only takes them a day to put our routes together anyway, so it shouldn't be too much of a disruption. I think a lot more of our kids are actually, we have a lot of kids who live right very close to downtown, so we may have kids who are walking. So that'll be great. Doyle is, yes, being very cooperative. That's about staying. They love having us there. They wish that we were going to stay forever. There are many things that we love about being in that space, so that's still a great relationship there. And we do have the clause, the extension clause, that's part of the lease agreement, so it's not going to be a problem to stay there. And the third question to ask you, I do not have staffing to take any more students than I have right now. Ideally, if the kids fell into the right groups, I could have 45 kids, because I have three full-time advisors and one part-time advisor. The square footage is equivalent. It's going to be much better laid out for us in the new space. The classrooms that we have right now are kind of long and narrow, and they're kind of awkward classroom spaces. These are going to be nice square classrooms with great lighting, and we're talking about finishing, just painting whiteboards on one wall and magnetic boards on the other, and really looking at how we can use that space effectively and both cost effectively and efficiently. But until we can have more staffing, we can't really up the number of students.
Thank you.
If I did have four full-time staff, I could tell you we could have 60 kids.
But we did lease the space for a specific square footage for a certain amount of students, so we'd have to go back and we negotiated the lease. We could get that other space, but we'd have to pay for it.
Right. And I'm talking about with the square footage that we're
within the current configuration, you could fit a maximum of how many?
I'm not an architect, I don't know how crowded it's going to be once we get in there, but with the four classroom spaces that we have, and if I had four full-time teachers, then I could potentially have 15 kids in each of those advisories, which would put us at 60 students.
And can you imagine what your full-time staff is now?
I have 3.6.
Other questions? Okay, do you want to continue on?
I have a quick challenge to you all. Wendy has raised the bar. She already sent me the contact for someone who runs a new business in town who is looking to have interns. One of the things that's really important for our kids is not only that they find the right place, but that they find the right adult to be their mentor. So I'm going to challenge you all to think about some people who would be good mentors for high school students who would really connect with kids well, and I'll reach out to you and maybe you can help us expand our pool of contacts.
I actually gave you two because I gave you James.
Come on, Aaron.
But then that leaves me with having.
You're the mentor.
Is there a place at the high school, a job board where job postings are? Because people call us all day long. Do you know anybody?
Yeah, well, actually, Trish Woodliffe is actually the main contact person for all of that work in the district. She's done a phenomenal job. She runs the job fairs in conjunction with the city.
Yeah.
And we've just done really good work. So I'll bring that to her attention tomorrow.
Just a good old fashioned bulletin board?
Yeah, bulletin board, either that or Lisa.
She channels all of that stuff to me. Yeah. And, you know, when people are contacting, Lisa's been great about this, yeah. Melissa as well.
All
you know,
day if, people call.
Like, you want to hire somebody, but I can get you a kid for free, but you also have to be their mentor, right? I mean, it takes a little bit more on their part, but it doesn't cost them financially. So those are the kind of relationships we're looking to build.
But if you could pull, you know, the old fashioned, the kid walks by, look up there, he's in the mood, or she's in the mood, they stop looking around. Let them take the responsibility, take a phone, right, picture of it, call, make the appointment, use their soft skills to get an interview, get in there, because all day long, it's pretty much.
That's great.
There used to be a bulletin board in the high school that did that, but that was done.
Then we don't get in the middle of it all, because people are looking for us to go out and make recommendations, and we're like, we don't do apartment, you know what I mean? We just can't do that anymore, because some of them don't turn up so good, so we don't want to be in the middle of it. We just want to make the referrals and say, look, make the connections between the different groups.
So maybe if we could advertise Trish Woodliffe as the connection person for the school.
Yeah,
department.
I think we could probably do something on the new website, too, that the kids could access. But we had conversations with the seniors that are at LCE this year, and the kids are well ahead of the game. They're all involved in internships. We had a couple of new students that were just getting their feet on the ground, but they've done an exceptional job of finding locations to work, and they've got it integrated into the schedule along with their academics. They've all passed the MCAS. So they're really a good group of kids. So
yeah, and we did a lot of work with kids that were coming as they transitioned over for them to be thinking about what they, you know, get them in the mindset of doing that internship thing. So the kids have come in like ready to go at every grade level. Very fantastic.
How many seniors?
Nine at the moment. We have maybe one more coming over from the high school. That's a place where I could take a few more kids because it's a smaller group.
Well, it's safe to say that just about everybody's hired. So
everybody's
any
hired.
Any students looking for a job?
That's great.
It's pretty much safe to say at this point, leading up to the holidays, I can't guarantee work after the holidays, but for right now, everybody's hired.
That's true.
Everybody.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Did you have more on your?
Nope. I just wanted to show you where to find us so you can check our progress.
So 4 months from now, when you say 4 months, you mean 4 months from?
I mean, end of
August 22nd or
August meant. Nicole meant end of December, but
end of
we'll
December.
See what we can.
We're hoping we can accelerate that because that was a little bit beyond what our original time frame was. So.
Well, he moves quick. I mean, if anybody's going to move,
yeah, it's
he moves quick.
There was one small question
because he wants the rent.
We talked about that this afternoon at LCET. Does the school have a Facebook?
Yes.
We're on Facebook, we're on Instagram.
Okay, Instagram,
Twitter,
Snapchat.
No, we're not Snapchat yet.
We're too old for Snapchat.
Just ask guys. Just asking.
Kids go there to get away from us.
So I'll tell you what we can, like, the power of Twitter, for example. I had a student from New York City this summer who lives in the Bronx. I connected him with a former student that I taught 20 years ago.
So
I'm not that old, but I taught 20 years ago in New York and Brooklyn.
With students by Twitter?
Through Twitter.
No?
Right?
Yes.
Made that connection for them through Twitter. Yeah, we can get with kids through Twitter, through Facebook.
Your Facebook is great. You guys do a good job.
Instagram, and the feed just comes up, you know, on all of these websites.
That's really good, that
there's
whole connection.
A
feed that's
connected
to all our
social
media. Keep pushing it out.
You have a blog?
I do not have a blog. I've been considering that.
I nominate Ron to run the blog.
Well, no, you have some.
I'm just asking. I'm his mentor.
Whether we like it or not, social media is governing our behavior,
right?
Absolutely, yes. So we're harnessing
it. Whether we like it or not, and if we don't write it, it's going to write us. It's as simple as that.
Kerry, you know what's really interesting? Is when they took all the businesses and they surveyed them all and they looked at sort of what's needed in public education, and you made me think of this, it's soft skills.
Absolutely.
It's amazing because everyone says, you bring us students with soft skills, we can train them to do just about everything because everyone's pretty much has their own either software that they use, they have their own something, open source, whatever it might be. So they have their own way of doing business. So the first thing they're going to do is train. It's kind of like police academy. We send people to the police academy for 22 weeks, and then they come back and we retrain them.
Right.
You know, to meet our, you know, so they fit our department. And the biggest demand continues to be soft skills, getting students prepared and getting them in, and then they'll take care of the rest. And I see that everywhere now is pretty much what we even hear from businesses, but I'm saying that's universal.
Yeah, that's a big part of our program with our students as we prepare them to make these phone calls and to do the shadow days and things. That's absolutely. And we have a lot of kids who are bilingual, and we're trying to help them and businesses understand the power of that bilingualism for our students.
We're ahead to run out for 1 second, so I'm sorry you already talked about this. Did we talk about your ability to move your furniture and outfit this place?
We did not. I know that Tony is going to help us move when the time comes. I know that like half our families have already been in touch and said, what can I do to help you move? So it'll be a great community event.
Furniture and chairs.
Yeah, we're going to have to purchase some new things. It's not clear to me at the moment exactly what stuff we have at Doyle that is ours to move, and so that's part of the work that I need to do this fall is figure out what's ours and what's theirs.
Well, make sure you talk to the business manager. Make sure we got the money to spend.
Well, I hear you have a charter school background, so I'm really good at helping to raise some funds for that as well.
So Jim's going to get back to us on what, because I know Dan had mentioned it, that
we have money budgeted, plus I have the inventory of what we had purchased originally when we started LCE. I thought I had scanned that to you, but I'll send that to you so you can start to double check what you have in the building.
There's and then much we can go from there. Is there much you can take from Doyle?
Yeah, because we had acquired quite a bit of equipment from Tahanto when they built their new building at the time. We got it at bargain prices. And so a lot of that within the science tables and things like that.
We can use those.
So we could bring all that over.
Yeah, I'm also hoping that we can maybe use this as an opportunity to rally a little enthusiasm and do sort of a fundraising.
If you put a list together of things that you need, that's the best thing, because then people know exactly this is what you need, how much is that, $200, they'll give you a check for $200.
Yeah.
If you say, you know what I mean, just get right to the point.
Because people love outfitting a new place, you know, people love bricks and mortars, and so.
Yep. All right. Good job.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Good luck on progress.
Thank you, Karen.
Okay. We are now on to subcommittee reports. Do we have any?
So, you can't come back and
tweet
the ballot. Our vote
has to be
together.
Oh, they didn't
tell you?
Do you think
he's going to leave?
He's going to
run out?
Do you think
he's going to run out screaming?
How long? Were you on 495?
Just at the park.
West
Bond? Come to the mic. Come on, Alice. Come to the mic.
All right. So while you're out walking out the door, we moved you up on the agenda to the vote. To offer you the job, right? Yeah. All we need is you to say yes, unless you change your mind from here to there.
I'll compile the contract. Yeah. You and I will be in touch. We'll work from there. So
congratulations.
Yes.
This could be a start of a very good relationship.
Oh, I love the time.
Welcome.
All right. Thank you.
Well.
I'll be in touch with you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you,
Glenn.
Bye.
Subcommittee, any finance?
I can get the finance.
Yes.
So we did not have a meeting tonight officially, because we're in the forum, but we do have the 16 numbers in, and right now we're going to work with the superintendent, Sean, to really build what I think 17 budget should look like. It looks like we're in a deficit of between $500,000 and $800,000, but we haven't factored in all the Title I money and some of this grant money that may be able to cover a lot of it. The one thing I'm concerned about is busing. We do have to talk about busing because we have about a $500,000 uncovered bill between what the city provides and then should we get the Medicaid reimbursement and then what we can cover with school choice, then it all becomes very, I'm not sure. So that's the one thing we're really gonna have to stay on top of and watch.
Well, we're going to have a new business manager, so we can sit down and go through some of some of those.
And maybe if the new LC site, she said they might have a lot of walkers, maybe we could have one less bus for that, and maybe that'll save us a few bucks.
Yeah. So we're going to make sure that we work on covering this, and hopefully we're going to kick out of 17 without catastrophe, and we'll work on building 18 as soon as we can get up numbers. And we didn't have a chance to do warrants, and we do need to transfer some money, things like that.
Do you want to do that tonight?
No. So Heather, so next Monday, 6:30.
Can I just check for one?
Yeah. I don't want to consume it. So what we'll do is we'll vote then, and then the next meeting we can do whatever we need to do as the school committee.
Yeah.
And it should just be a quick one. So the superintendent's going to work with Sean on doing the bigger things so that we need to do and get that straight, so we can give you a good 17.
How are we set with sort of, this is my yearly question, supplies?
Well, we're in good shape, okay. And we made sure of that because of a couple of years ago we ended up having visitors to the committee, made sure that there was adequate not only building supplies but instructional supplies, paper, etc. So the only thing that may have been backtracked a little bit with a few curriculum materials, but those are either on their way in, so shouldn't have any issues. So.
Okay, great chaplain. It's a one person, one clerical person department.
Yeah.
And he pushed out.
That's right.
Incredible amounts of work this year. I mean, he was there Saturdays and Sundays. And I just like to thank him because he really did.
You know, he did a great job for us because we had quite a list of stuff and he helped us out. So.
Stuff. And that, not to mention the roof, all the paving jobs, yep. All the small and large jobs that we had, he pushed them. He's almost there, you know, getting close.
Great.
Thank you.
Anything on the policy?
No, we haven't had that yet, sure.
We will go to approve of the minutes from July 28th.
So that was finance subcommittee.
Oh, so we'll
not done.
Can I just ask, we're meeting next meeting, right? I mean,
yes,
yes,
we are. Yep, we always meet the second. Right, I'm just making sure we're.
Yep.
And then new rural business, remind us, school committee offsite with Nancy Walser, September 17th. She's going to be sending out evaluation on the protocols, just to show everybody the protocols, and then everyone evaluates the protocols. What do you think?
And in addition to that, I'm completing a draft of my goals, and you'll have that by the weekend. So you'll have it about a week ahead of time so that we can talk about that at the offsite and then hopefully move that along this year so we don't have as many delays in the approval of my goals for the year. So.
Where are we meeting?
We're just meeting here at Apple Seeds on the 17th from 8 until noontime. So.
Are we all set with the two groups that are going in for 10 minutes apiece for the charter school?
I haven't gotten the opposition in line yet. I think Cody did some work on the...
because somebody
I just sent Chris the information.
Okay. Right. So I'll work on the other piece. So
on the other part, the old business, like Eileen, my son, provide service to the athletes, the doing service of the Navy. And he had been doing all the years on a volunteer basis, so I'm getting paid. And so there was a question of whether it was a conflict of interest on my part. I didn't know anything about it. So I went to City Hall and filled out the papers, so there's no conflict of interest on my part. It was all filled out and everything. It's a City Hall. So. The other part of the picture is I went to a meeting this afternoon. And at LC18, there was a couple of things that we were banding about. One, should there be a subcommittee, part of the school committee, on social media? That's something I'm throwing out. Secondly, in the handbooks, because of the various sundry reasons, with pre-form, there's nothing in the handbooks stating that, you know, pre-prom, that the parents should come and have a chat regarding their responsibilities for the kids going to prom. And they told me, when they asked, they didn't tell me, I told them that I would check on listserv, finding out what other school district, what do they do regarding pre-prom, how they make the parents come have the meeting 2 or 3 weeks or a month before the pre-prom. Just putting that out there for you guys.
Ron stopped it after the meeting. The two recommendations that I made was mostly social media. I think we can address in policy. But if the committee feels differently, we can do something different. And regarding pre-prom, that's been evolving. So I think we need to give the individuals who are trying to promote that process ample time. I know that Chris Laud was working on it. I know that Kathy Gaudette was working on it. And a few other people. I think we need to give that time to evolve before we actually make it a handbook item. But I think both issues are appropriate issues to continue under discussion.
So. And the other part of the picture is September 26th or 27th, I'm going to the Fire and Life Safety Education Conference in Westbury. It's going to be my third year in a row going there. They always have group information that has been banning about at the state level. And so, yes, I'm paying out of my own pocket. And I'll bring back the information and I'll share with everyone what they brought up, what they're proposing, and what they're coming out with. Because it was 1 year I came back and had to show Jim something that was coming out. But that's it.
Anything else for the new role business? If not, the motion will adjourn. No?
Okay. I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Sure. All in favor? Okay.
Thank you all.
See you. Is the 17th the next time we're
going to meet? 17th is the workshop, 19th is the next meeting. Thank you.